Hi there, John Hardy here with the Saxo Bank Video FX Update and Weekly Wrap for this week. Give it a little subtitle of your uh-oh today after some pretty amazing action in Euro downside, which we'll get to here in a moment. Things are remaining interesting, that's for sure, after yesterday's amazing moves in commodities, particularly oil. And the commodity is still getting a lot of the headlines. We do have momentum off, but some of the wildness is certainly not off, especially if we look at crude oil market, you know, falling another several dollars, rallying $7, and then falling back four more dollars into the close. Clearly, there's still plenty of energy in the market there, though if we look at precious metals, we're having a pretty strong close on the day for gold. This outcome in gold could be connected possibly to the reasons for the euro weakness, more sovereign debt worries on Greece, etc. Again, we'll get to that in a moment. But the silver market calmed quite a bit. still pretty wild back and forth, but it's only off. Looks like we're going to close less than a dollar off on the silver contract. We had today's, of course, main focus. Coming into the day was the U.S. non-farm payrolls report and employment report in general. After 2 days in the U.S. of incredible data surprises with this ISM non-manufacturing seeing a massive miss and the jobless claim spiking so high yesterday, the market certainly on edge coming into this report, and so when it came out strong, the market got pretty excited about that when there was plenty of fear and blood in the streets already. And we saw a pretty big snapback rally, but then we're closing the day rather weak on risk and risk off. So very interesting back and forth there. If you look at the bond market, for example, Treasuries just got absolutely creamed in the hour or so after the employment report, and actually managed to finish or trade to new highs in the day, new lows in the yield. Euro bonds hardly took a hit at all. And of course, one of the reasons out there for this, one of the bigger fish to fry, if you will, is the whole situation with the euro. We had, first of all, Trichet out in some interviews and the press conference referring to the currency and the market putting two and two together, apparently, and saying that the ECB policy, for the first time, more explicitly anyway, being linked somewhat to the currency's strength. So the ECB clearly feeling some discomfort with the euro at close to 150 and having too hawkish of an outlook. And this was in addition to all the parsing of the statement yesterday and the language that suggests they're going to skip another meeting before hiking rates again. And as well, the whole linkage of oil prices and headline commodity inflation risk to the ECB rate, which is justified because it's these inflation indicators that have the ECB most worried about inflation in the first place. Then we have Der Spiegel out with an article claiming it has the inside track on the possibility that Greece is looking to devalue and exit from the euro. This would be great news for Greece. I hope we should all hope they do this, just in terms of the economic rationality of it. But, of course, all sides denying that there's a Brussels emergency meeting in Brussels. Apparently there is some meeting in Brussels, but it's on other unrelated issues. Nonetheless, this is coming after a pretty nervous week to begin with. But we're seeing a two-day fall in euro, the likes of which we've not seen since the month of the Lehman bankruptcy. Just to give a little perspective here and to show how massively things have unwound, again, underlining our point that sometimes in these counter trend moves, when you've had a grinding trend going one way for so long, when whatever excuse comes along for it to come unwound, the volatility can be surprisingly asymmetric and violent, and that's what we've seen this time around. And here I'm going to take a little divergence into another presentation I've been working on for something else. I think this will be interesting to cover today as well, just giving us the weekly perspective of what's going on as well in the bigger picture here. I also hope everyone likes this very dynamic and attractive format I've prepared for you. I apologize for the small typeface. This has to do with, of course, the limitations of PowerPoint on a flattened screen. Anyway, so this week we saw what? Commodities obviously have a huge crash in certain commodities prices. Is this simply the margin call issue with, and especially with silver? or has smart money headed for the exits? I would say all of the above, at least for the short term anyway. And just in perspective, again, silver 8 weeks of heady gains gone in 1 week, copper new low for the year. That latter very significant, as we've been talking about on the whole Chinese uses of copper, etc. Equities, we had gap open euphoria on the Osama bin Laden death, but it kind of ends on a weak note, and we'll get to that closing level in a minute, as it just happened as we started this video. Bonds, strong upside on risk aversion. We've been talking about this for a while, and this was happening even before this week's risk off theme developed, at least the latter half of this week. Emerging markets looking a bit shaky in places. For example, Brazil closer to a 10-month low than a 10-month high, even despite the S&P, for example, posting a high for the cycle this week, the beginning of the week. And Asian tigers have been the outperformers. Currencies, we saw a big carry trade unwind, especially later in the week, and in particular, yen, Swiss, and the dollar smashing stronger. The Swiss getting quite a boost today on this euro business going on. Aussie, not so much Aussie, CAD as well, although Aussie has been weaker, CAD been weaker, Kiwi's been a bit weaker, and the euro has been one of the weakest currencies this week, as have the Scandis, to put things in perspective. And we already talked about this, why the euro is weak. Well, what does it mean? What does this week's movements mean? Well, we've had this very long trend. It's been going on for a long time. You can all trace it to the August 27th Jackson Hole Bernanke speech that hinted at Q2. That got this whole thing going. And the easy part of the trend is over. We're not going to say here, it's too early to say, too early days to say that this trend is going to reverse from here. It's all over with. However, with a move of this magnitude, the risk, technically speaking, of a sideways market at best, this is going to be the dominant scenario, that this has done some damage to the trend. Yes, we could revisit the highs, etc., maybe even go beyond those highs, but the sideways a sideways market, more sideways market, is the most likely scenario from here, at least not a return to the easy, grinding, sort of everyday up kind of trend we were saying previously. And that's not a sure odds thing, that's a guess, an odds-on guess. So that we see a volatile range and not necessarily a climactic unwind in the here and now. Lessons learned. Well, we saw a couple lessons from this cycle. One of those lessons is we should always pay attention to the bond market if it's not fitting with the overall macro story. And it wasn't. And that red flag proved to be an interesting one as it sort of tipped its hat to what was going to happen later on in terms of the carry trade unwind, in terms of the risk-off move in some places. Another thing we learned is that at least this time around, Bill Gross certainly was a lousy timer. Seems like he was making all these noises about being net short of U.S. Treasuries just at the point where they launched the most vicious part of their rally. So he's either a lousy timer or he was hoping to get better prices for a massive buy. I'm not any kind of anti-Bill Gross person, don't get me wrong, but I thought that was pretty interesting to see the Bond King get it so incredibly wrong, at least relative to his official statements. Even if maybe he does turn out to be right further down the road. This is just for this part of the cycle, obviously. As well, if you look at some of the material stocks out there, they were sending some warning signs ahead of what we saw happening in the commodities market. So that's always a good idea to match up a few commodities equities when looking at commodities, just as a reality check. A couple of charts here. This one's very small. I apologize for this. Basically, we're just showing four instruments here. We're showing silver, the black line. We have the Brent crude, the light blue line you probably almost can't see, and the darker blue line being the S&P 500, and everything launches into its massive bull market with the hint of QE2 on August 27th at Jackson Hole from Bernanke. That's around when the dollar was seeing a minor peak here. The reason it saw some downside here was because we saw the climax of the May 6th flash crash, fallout, unwinding, then we were back to neutral, and then QE2 hinted that dollar goes straight down almost for several months. So we had a definite beginning to this thing. We also have a definite knowledge of when the end of QE2 happens, and that at least has to cause, even if you're a dollar bear for the longer term with very good reason, It has to cause some measure of uncertainty on what happens next, because the whole paradigm of what's going on now has been built up around QE2, and we know that it's coming to an end in 55 days. Just on a weekly, this is a bit random, sorry about this. We're going to cover the regular charts as well in a moment. Emerging markets not doing too well for the week. This was before we get this is a weekly candlestick on the MSCI Emerging Market Equities. Evening Star here, and this could extend a little bit on whatever the Friday happened on Friday. We don't get the full information until after the close on this index. And this was just something I thought of earlier today, kind of interesting with crude oil off so massively. You can see how crude oil and Mexican peso versus the dollar, this would be peso dollar in black, how they are slightly correlated, as you can see from this one-year chart. You get an incredible move in crude, and the Mexican peso hasn't weakened as much as one might expect. So interesting to see if that correlation holds. And no reason to expect it not to, but keep an eye on that one if you trade the peso. Now, charts. Try to give a daily and a weekly perspective. Again, the massive, massive two-day drop. Yesterday, we managed to stop at this line of support here. Now we're just crunching through to new low prices. One would suppose the 142.50 area might be the next area of support there. Technically, you'd like to see quite a bounce before getting any indication on when the bleeding stops. Cable at 164.20, more or less held today. That's the key sort of pivot area there, or through the trend line. Euro sterling, massive downside. This is, of course, euro negativity playing in here. This 87.50 area has been kind of interesting. And with this kind of momentum built up, it looks like that top is going to be safe for some time. The question being at what rate it falls down again, but I would say we get through 55-day moving average, it could be opening up for the 200-day moving average. Again, Swiss franc is also considered the safe haven from euro woes, so if euro woes continue and the euro risk trade is off, in other words, exposure to euro trade is on, or if, in other words, the people are trying to reduce their exposure to the euro, we're seeing it go to these lowest closing levels right after the earthquake, and not so far from the 124 plus levels we saw back around the beginning of the year. That trade could go anywhere, one would suspect, if we really get going on restructurings, especially if we get going on an actual exit or devaluation from the likes of Greece or another country, let's say Ireland. Somewhat the same goes for euro-yen, though we have the element of the uncertainty surrounding Japanese sovereign rating in the mix there. Dollar-yen, again, fiddling with this Ichimoku cloud level, as we talked about recently. It's in the cloud now. 80 is also a key psychological level. We have to be aware of the short term of any intervention, even if that intervention might fail in the short term. And, of course, correlation with the bond market is rather obvious. Lately as well. Here is a crude, the June crude, Brent crude contract, off as much as $20 this week. Quite a bounce, but we're also well off the highs of the day. And wild trading going on there. Dollar Canada at a critical level. We forgot to do some weekly candles here. Let's do a weekly candle on Dollar Canada. You can see how we've engulfed the last several weeks of action, and this 55-day moving average, 96.75 area, quite obviously an interesting level here. Punch through that, we're probably talking about parity being interesting, which coincidentally resides up close to the 200-day moving average. This is the weekly, and basically engulfing candlestick on Aussie, but if you look at the size of the engulfing stick relative to this recent rally, actually still in remarkably good shape, if you ask me, considering we've seen a commodity consolidation of the degree we've had. There was a bit of support for Aussie overnight. In fact, this is what took it to well over 107 and even at 108 at one point. The RBA was out with some, what was it, growth projections or something silly like this. The market really reacted strongly to it. I would say, of course, going forward, these kind of things don't matter as much as what's going on in the commodities markets and risk appetite. So keep that in mind. Kiwi also seeing a bounce. Silver, there's your weekly perspective on silver. An incredible move. 8 weeks wiped out in the space of one. For today specifically, momentum coming off, which means we've stopped sort of the accelerating downside. Could be space for a bounce there next week. Dollar MEX, again, a bit at odds with the size of this consolidation, with the size of the crude oil consolidation. But if crude bounces back, it looks like you're in good shape on the Mexican peso, so very interesting to watch that correlation. Here's our BHP Billiton stock, and again, you know, if you look at the likes of silver, etc., pretty sedate action here, but some of these material stocks, not so much BHP, but some of the broader indices, were not showing really new highs as commodities were resolutely marching to new highs. And that's kind of interesting for noting the divergence. We're seeing short sterling, a new high here, but the momentum coming off, in other words, lower expectations for the Bank of England, and again, lower still for the ECB. Getting close to these lows. In fact, if you look at the interest rates benchmark, which you never see on a Bunds chart, but the actual interest rate, we're at a new low for the recent trading levels. And on the weekly perspective, we are trading below this old high. And on a weekly perspective on the S&P 500, almost an engulfing candlestick, not quite, at least a dark cloud, we can call it, right at a tipping point with that level here. You could argue from an Elliott wave perspective, maybe 1, 3, 5, but certainly a candlestick that represents uncertainty at best for the short term for equities. And this was the anniversary, by the way, of the flash crash that happened last year, where we saw a crazy downside on basically due to market mechanisms that failed to put support into the market when it was needed and when liquidity dried up. So lots to focus on as we go through next week. There are a couple of key things to watch for besides everything that's going on already, the commodities unwind, the story surrounding Greece, whether there's any contagion risk popping up in the other spreads outside of the Greek spreads. Because as a one-off thing, Greece saying c'est la vie, or what do you call it, saying sayonara to the EU is not necessarily, in financial terms, a devastating blow, but of course it raises contagion risk, and that's what we have to price in, looking into whether the story goes somewhere next week. Sorry for these slides popping up in the wrong spot, not sure what's going on there. But looking ahead, what do we have next week? We've talked about this yesterday. We have a U.S. budget deal possibly on its way ahead of May 16th. Looks like both parties want to deal now. Looks like they want to avoid the embarrassment of a shutdown possibly, but let's see if they can come to a deal on the budget. And again, looks like they want to leave the entitlements as much alone as possible, even though those are the most important budget items longer term. And to make those entitlement issues basically to make the 2012 election a referendum on those entitlement issues, how to deal with reducing Medicare, Medicaid spending, etc. We also have China and U.S. strategic dialogue starting on Monday. And, of course, the items of contention include Fed policy and how this is aggravating monetary policy problems and inflation elsewhere in the world, particularly for China, which is unwisely pegged to the U.S. dollar and causes all kinds of problems in a higher growth economy. And, of course, from the U.S. side, the Chinese want the Chinese to continue to revalue their currency. And we've seen headlines on this. There have been a lot of moves by China that are considered very controversial in terms of human rights issues that the U.S. has started to protest again, and China is getting in its sort of mode of lecturing the U.S. about not telling it what to do on human rights. I think it's pretty embarrassing for the U.S. to go into this meeting without saying a single thing, considering what the USA represents traditionally in terms of values of liberty and freedom. So this will be an interesting one to watch to see if the rhetoric gets any sharper on that issue or on other issues. So keep that one in mind as well. And again, overall here, we're looking at how do we transition to a new market paradigm after this very dramatic move Does the fat tail get fatter, as we were talking about yesterday? There is that risk out there, and once the volatility has started to expand, the risk is high that it continues to expand, but it doesn't mean it's high odds in an absolute sense. It just means it's higher odds than it was before. So do we transition to a volatile market, simply back and forth, or do we have a risk of a further panic? Let's see what happens. Our default scenario is that we're at least settling into a more range-bound market as we look towards the end of QE2, T-minus 55 days, and as the market ponders where things will go next. And this could mean, again, that this one-way easy trend is over with for now, and that it could be treacherous on either side of the trade, trying to jump against the old trend, because we can see these amazing snapbacks, or to try to get back on it because, again, volatility is a two-way, it could be a two-way street here. So be careful out there. Have a wonderful weekend. Add me to your Twitter stream, at John J. Hardy. I send out things on occasion that I hope everyone finds of interest. I thank you, all of my followers out there. I've added a few lately, and thanks a lot for following, and as long as we continue to build that, it helps me to build further content for sending out to you all. So take care out there, and that's it for now. We'll see you back next week with further editions of the Saxo Bank video update.